Good morning and welcome to the fourth meeting of Citizens' Participation and Public Petitions Committee in 2024. Our convener, Jackson Carlow, is unable to attend today, meeting today and sends his apologies as he is attending the funeral of his constituent and Holocaust survivor, Henry Wooger. The first item on our agenda today is a decision in taking items 4 and 5 in private. Item 4 relates to a consideration of evidence we are about to hear on Petition 1933, while item 5 relates to consideration of the committee's work programme. Are members agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. The next item on our agenda today is a consideration of continued petitions, the first of which is an evidence session on Petition 1933, allow the former Nephi survivors to access Scotland's redress scheme, lodged by Iris Tinto on behalf of the Nephi Survivors Group. I understand that members of survivor groups have joined us in the public gallery this morning. A warm welcome to you all. As we have a very busy public gallery, I would remind all those joining us this morning that you are welcome to observe the proceedings. However, we are asked to keep the noise to a minimum and do not seek to interrupt the consideration of a petition. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to widen access to Scotland's redress scheme to allow for Nephi survivors to seek redress. We last considered the petition at our meeting on the 3rd of May 2023 when we agreed to invite the Deputy First Minister to give evidence, and I am pleased to welcome the Deputy First Minister, Shona Robertson, to committee this morning. We are also joined by Scottish Government officials, Lindsay Wilson, Unit Head of Policy and Communications, Redress, Relations and Response Division, Barry McCaffrey, Lawyer, Scottish Government Legal Directorate of Children, Education, Rights and Cooperation and Disclosure Division. Before I invite the Deputy First Minister to provide some brief opening remarks, I know that since we last considered the position, there has been a members' business debate on the justice for the Nephi survivors. The Scottish Government also appointed an independent researcher to make inquiries in respect of the Nephi House, which this committee has been provided with a copy of a researcher's report, which is now available on the petition webpage. The committee has also received two new submissions from the petitioners commenting on the parliamentary debate and detailing ongoing challenges in engaging with the redress scheme, highlighting the response one survivor received that a decision panel would likely disregard their placement at Nephi when considering the application for redress. We had also received a submission from Professor Diana McCaldy, researcher's appointment by Nephi Survivors Group, providing further information on the operation of Nephi House and potential options for amending the existing eligibility criteria for the redress scheme. Having provided that update, we are now able to invite the Deputy First Minister to give you a brief statement. Deputy First Minister.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the committee and those in the gallery. I'm grateful for the opportunity to provide evidence to the committee regarding petition PE1993. But before I get into redress matters, can I begin by putting on the formal record my acknowledgement of the abhorrent abuse that some children suffered while resident in Nephi House. It should not have happened, and I'm sorry to hear about what they had to endure as children and the impact the abuse has had on their lives. Both I and the First Minister have met with the Nephi survivors, and I very much recognise and commend their courage in sharing their experiences. Turning to the matters outlined in the petition, as the committee are aware, I instructed the appointment of an independent researcher to make inquiries into Nephi House. Dr. Fossey took up post on the 1st of August last year with a remit to investigate the circumstances by which a child would be placed in Nephi House and to establish what records may exist relating to Nephi House. Dr. Fossey has concluded her inquiries and her full report has been shared with the committee. As the committee has had the opportunity to consider the report ahead of today's evidence session, I'm not going to repeat the findings, but I want to turn to how they affect the eligibility of Nephi survivors to access Scotland's redress scheme. Part 3 of the Redress for Survivors Historical Child Abuse and Care Scotland Act 2021 sets out the eligibility of the scheme, which includes residents in a relevant care setting in Scotland. Section 20 of the Act defines a relevant care setting to include residence in a residential institution in which the day-to-day care of children was provided by or on behalf of a person other than a parent or guardian of the child. Moreover, a residential institution refers to a variety of different care settings, such as children's homes, residential care facilities and school-related accommodation, which are as further defined in Section 21 of the Act. Section 23 of the Act, however, allows Scottish ministers to make regulations to create exceptions to eligibility. The Exceptions to Eligibility SSI, is approved by Parliament before the scheme opened in 2021, provides that an application for redress may not be made by or in respect of a person to the extent that it relates to abuse that occurred when that person was resident in a relevant care setting, A, for the purpose of being provided with short-term respite or holiday care, and B, under arrangements made between a parent or guardian of that person and another person. Where the exceptions apply, a key point in assessing eligibility is the purpose of the stay in the relevant care setting and whether this has been made under arrangements with a child's parent or guardian. Whilst records from the period are limited, the report is clear that children attended Ferneithy House primarily on a short-term basis for convalescence or a recuperative holiday under arrangements involving their parent or guardian and another person. Those circumstances, as agreed by Parliament, are excluded from the scheme. It's important to acknowledge at this point that in the absence of individual records, it's not possible to say with certainty that parents gave their informed consent to their child attending Ferneithy House. We can only speak to what was supposed to happen. The legislation speaks of arrangements made with a child's parent or guardian, and that is what is relevant for redress purposes. The redress scheme is primarily designed for those children who were in long-term care, and the exceptions are in keeping with that purpose. This rationale was supported by 79% of respondents to a public consultation issued in advance of the legislation being drafted. In addition, there is the key issue of the absence of records relating to Ferneithy House. Every applicant to the redress scheme is required to provide evidence that they were in a relevant care setting at a particular time. Unfortunately, the absence of records means that Ferneithy survivors, even if the eligibility criteria were to be changed, are unlikely to meet the evidential requirements of the scheme. For all of these reasons, I do not intend to change the eligibility criteria for the scheme. I recognise that the outcome of the inquiries will be disappointing to those survivors who seek redress. The report's findings are in no way intended to diminish the experience of the survivors or to suggest that the parents of these children were in any way responsible for the experiences the children had during their time in Ferneithy House. I'm very grateful to the committee for their ongoing support of the Ferneithy survivors and for the Scotland Redress Scheme, and I'm happy to answer any questions that you have.
Thank you for that, Deputy First Minister. We'll move to questions now, and I'm quite happy to open them up. Deputy First Minister, can you expand on the aims and findings of a research into Ferneithy House?
Yeah, I can, convener. So there, we set out the requirement and for a piece of independent research that was a six-month piece of research. Dr. Fossey was asked to find out why and by whom girls were sent to Ferneithy, what Glasgow City Council has done to find records from Ferneithy. I emphasise again, and Dr. Fossey has made this point, what she has said in her report was what was supposed to happen, and that's not to diminish the experiences of what actually happened to survivors as part of the Ferneithy group. The executive summary headline findings, just to summarise why the girls were sent to Ferneithy, the findings were that primary school girls from Glasgow were sent to convalescence after an illness and or so that they might benefit from what was termed a recuperative holiday. The school was one of a number of schemes of residential education which was aimed at improving the health of pupils. In terms of who sent them, it was head teachers and school medical staff could put forward girls that they thought might benefit from a stay. However, it was the school or principal medical officer who took the final decision. And even then, only girls whose parent or guardian agreed to them going and who passed two medical examinations were allowed to go. In terms of the records, the regulations at the time obliged education authorities to keep school registers, pupil progress reports and health records only until the end of the fifth, or in some cases the second year after the year for which it was held or the pupil had left. After that time, the records were to be destroyed. Therefore, it's not surprising that Glasgow City Council has found no such records in the city archives. That said, as Dr. Fossey has noted, a question remains over the lack of Fornetti's logbook. The regulations require these to be preserved, and it should be noted, though, that Fornetti is not unique in having no surviving logbooks. In terms of the records information on Fornetti that Glasgow City Council holds, basically what Dr. Fossey found is that Glasgow City Council holds no school records for Fornetti. The City Archives holds various series of Council Education Committee minutes, papers, reports and handbooks that talk of Fornetti and other schools in the schemes, but no individual records. In terms of what action Glasgow City Council has taken to find existing records, they have run their own internal searches in response to FOI and subject access requests. And of course, Dr. Fossey and Diane McCarty had access to records in the archives. And Glasgow's chief archivist themselves has also carried out proactive searches for information on Fornetti. So I hope, convener, that gives you a sense of what the remit was and what the kind of key findings that have been found are.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. Oliver Dare, you've got a supplementary to my question?
Yeah, no, I'm to be honest, appalled by that answer, because I think I understand why the report was commissioned, but I don't think it's consistent with what the previous Deputy First Minister and then Education Secretary said as the bill went through Parliament. I was on and off that committee through that time, but he acknowledged that there wouldn't be, he said it was unlikely that documentary evidence would be available in every circumstance. He didn't talk about certainty, he talked about on the balance of probabilities. He offered repeat reassurances that people would be believed, that the principle would be that where survivors came forward and they offered testimony, that would be taken as fact, not that it would be questioned. And the second thing I find pretty hard to swallow, given it was discussed through the passage of the bill, is this relationship that's been presented between parents and the local authority. It's not true. It is not true. It is not factually correct. And it's still not correct to this day. Local authorities, through social work, through education, wield a huge amount of authority over families, where they suggest things and direct things. Vulnerable families feel under pressure to accept them. It is not a relationship of equals, and I think it is wrong to categorise the relationship in that way. And I would have hoped, you know, given what we hear from survivors, you know, that we'd be looking to find a way to say yes, rather than finding reasons to say no. So I'd be interested in what the Deputy First Minister had to say, both on the commitments that were given through the bill, and secondly, on that relationship she sets out with local authorities, because that, even now, you know, in 2023, is not my experience, or 2024 rather, is not my experience, you know, of what it's like for many families in my constituency.
Can I first of all say, look, I recognise very much the point you're making about what the relationship is and the unequal relationship, and I'm not disputing that at all. The point I'm making is that when the bill was taken through by my predecessor, the distinction that was made was for those who were in long-term care, where parental responsibility and children had been essentially removed from their parents through legislation, social work legislation primarily. Fornetti was established through education legislation. And I'm not disputing whether the opaqueness of whether parental consent was given. What I'm saying is what was supposed to happen rather than necessarily what the individual experiences were.
Should be responding to what did happen rather than what should. And it's another example of the failing that people have come up against in the system. The system has not been working as it should. So you wouldn't expect that just to be dismissed and say, well, it should have been done different.
And
that's kind of what it sounds like.
Well, I'm certainly not dismissing that. What I'm saying is that the records, the lack of records, don't give way to evidence in terms of what that parental involvement was or wasn't. What I'm saying is that the legislation underpinning what was essentially the setting up of the redress scheme was for those children who had been removed from parents through social work legislation, where there was no contact, where parental responsibility had been entirely removed. I mean, in terms of the apology given by my predecessor, he made the apology, of course, prior to the redress scheme being established, and it was to all survivors in all settings. And I absolutely want to reiterate that, absolutely, fully. The point, though, about the evidential requirements for Redress Scotland, the Redress Scotland scheme here is more broadly drawn than any other redress scheme anywhere in the world at the moment. In fact, if you look at redress schemes that have been established, most of them are far more tightly drawn than the one here in Scotland. But in order for an application to be brought in front of Redress Scotland, evidence is required. So there has to be records showing
There doesn't have to be records. I know that from my own constituents. What you have to prove is, on the balance of probabilities, something was more likely to have happened than not. And you know, I'm aware of payments being made to people who haven't been able to find records, but have been able to put other circumstantial evidence together to support an application. And in this case, you know, we've got a great many people from various parts of Scotland, particularly in the Glasgow area, who are able to corroborate and confirm that the experiences other people are talking about are the same as theirs. That starts to look to me like something that would meet that test, you know, or certainly that should get far enough through the process that Redress Scotland could make an analysis of the evidence. But because of the individual nature of the applications going forward, we're not looking at that collective picture, and that to me isn't consistent with what your predecessor said when he recognised that this was a grey area, that these issues were very difficult, and that they would have to be looked at in detail. But if they can't even be looked at in detail, how do you work out whether or not it meets the balance of probabilities test?
Well, I'm going to ask Lindsay to come in around the guidance that Redress Scotland use in terms of the evidential requirements, if that would be helpful. Lindsay, do you want to come?
Okay. Yeah, so it depends on what application you submit to Redress Scotland, whether it's a fixed rate application or an individually assessed payment. For a fixed rate payment, you will have to provide some evidence of being in care at a particular time. So the statutory guidance gives you a list of things. I can give you some examples, or I can send it on separately to the committee. But what we're looking for is some evidence or some supporting document that confirms that a child was in care at a particular time before the 1st of December 2004. And we recognise that there are some individuals just don't have that evidence, as you say. But so there are exceptional circumstances which Redress Scotland are allowed to consider, and I'm assuming that's the examples that you're given there. But I think the difficulty for the Ferneti survivors is that, as Emma has said in her report, as Dr. Fossey has said in her report, that they're not unique in having no records. There are no records at all. So some people might be able to provide social work records or education records, GP records, a letter from an archivist. There's a range of different things that are available for survivors to apply for the redress scheme. But I think, unfortunately, the difficulty for some of the ladies, and certainly I'm sure not all, is that proving that they were in care in the first place. And that's the starting point for any redress application.
And then you go back to what the Deputy First Minister previous said, which was that people would be believed.
Yeah.
And that was going to be the core of this whole process.
Yeah.
And now we're hearing that's not the case, and that can't be right.
I don't think anyone.
I can't sign up to that. I'm sorry.
Well, no one is disbelieving anyone, and let me just be really clear about that. But the core aim of the scheme, as set up by my predecessor, was very clear. It was to focus on those who had essentially been in long-term care. Who had been removed from parental responsibility. And that was the core purpose of the scheme. And that was, of course, unanimously agreed by Parliament. And a line was drawn in recognition of the priority given to those children. That's not to deny the experiences of anyone else, whether it's in short-term convalescent care or boarding schools for that matter, but the core aim of the scheme, as my predecessor was very clear, as agreed by Parliament and of course the public consultation, 79% of people agreed with that being the purpose of the scheme. That's absolutely not to question the experiences of anybody, and I would absolutely be really, really clear that everyone should absolutely be believed. But in terms of the scheme, the redress scheme, that was the core purpose for all the reasons that my predecessor set out, and that was accepted and agreed by Parliament for all of the reasons that were debated at the time.
Yeah, I'm going to get in trouble for going on, so I will not say anything further.
Fergus Ewan, you've got a small supplementary.
Yes, thanks, Convener. We're indebted to Professor Dan McCarry for a submission of the 11th of March 2024, and just reading therefrom, she states, the purpose of redress for historical institutional child abuse should be to benefit survivors. Currently, the eligibility guidelines specifically exclude survivors of short-term residential school abuse. This is unjust. That's correct, surely. Surely, Deputy First Minister, your statement today is actually perpetrating a manifest injustice.
Well, let me say, first of all, as I said in my opening remarks, I very much recognise the harm and the experience of those in Fernethy. And I put on record my views around that. I also reiterated the former Deputy First Minister's apology predating the scheme to anyone who had suffered abuse. I would reiterate and absolutely support that apology that was given. But the scheme that was agreed unanimously by this Parliament is designed for those vulnerable children who were in long-term care, isolated with limited or no contact with their families, and the eligibility criteria for the scheme reflects that core purpose and was supported, of course, by survivors who responded to the public consultation and, as I said, agreed by Parliament unanimously. And it was necessary at the time, as the former DFM said, to establish clear expectations of the parameters to enable clarity to be available to people from the start of the scheme. And that is why the scheme, which is very broad, much broader than most other schemes. If you look at the other schemes elsewhere in the world, or indeed the one that's been developed for England and Wales, is far more tightly drawn than Scotland's redress scheme. But I would suggest that a line had to be drawn somewhere, and the line that was drawn was to focus on those vulnerable children who were in long-term care, who had parental responsibility removed.
Well, I hear what you say, Deputy First Minister, but with respect, it doesn't really answer the question which I asked, which is that it's surely unjust to deny people who have been subject to abuse, albeit for a shorter period, a redress and compensation. I mean, surely, I'm just asking as a matter of principle, if you please would give a direct answer. Surely this is unjust. It's a manifest, patent injustice, and surely that just is indisputable.
Well, the principle is the same as the committee looked at previously when the former DFM was in front of the Education Committee, which I think you were a member of, and I think Oliver Mundell was also a member of. These were exactly those issues that were debated.
I wasn't at that time, I don't think.
Well, these were the issues that were debated.
I wasn't a member at that time. I don't think so, anyway.
Well, I've got the record here. You were... I've got the record here in terms of the debate that took place. And essentially, those very same issues that I'm articulating here today were articulated by my predecessor. They were debated and essentially the decision was unanimous to support the scheme as established. I've got the committee record here, which was... back in 2018, 27th of October 2021, when these matters were debated at length, exactly the same issues about the eligibility of the scheme and the exceptions, and the decision at that time, due to all of the same reasons I'm giving you here today, was exactly those conclusions on a unanimous basis.
Well, just one final question then, Deputy First Minister. I mean, even if we accept all that you say is true, let's just accept that for a moment, which we don't, but let's just assume that was the case, then that doesn't mean we can't put things right now. And Professor McCaddy recommended three very clear and practical ways and options in which we could do it. So, I mean, can we not just admit, be big enough to admit we got it wrong, but let's put it right? Is that not what this Parliament is for?
So you can go back and you can look at the record yourself, Mr Ewing. In terms of looking at the situation now, I've outlined why the eligibility criteria was established as it was. It is far broader than any other scheme. I've said that this scheme is focused and is working hard to deliver for those who were in long-term care with removed from parental responsibility. I've also outlined to you the difficulties of the evidential requirements that the Redress Scotland require. There are no records, not just for Ferneithy, but for the many other schools where people were in for very short terms for a number of weeks. There are no records for those because the system at the time, rightly or wrongly, didn't require those records to be retained. So it would be very difficult to ask Redress Scotland to take on thousands and thousands of cases where there's no evidential material existing to try to work through those cases when they are focused on the core purpose of the scheme. If you look at the schemes elsewhere, as I said at the beginning, Scotland's redress scheme is far broader than any other scheme that I'm aware of anywhere else in the world.
Thank you, Fergus. Deputy First Minister, are you aware of the reasons why Ferneithy survivors did not engage with the independent researcher? And do you have a sense of whether this has impacted on the findings and the research?
Well, I understand that Dr. Fossey had tried to engage with survivors. I don't know why that was the case. I do know, obviously, that Diane McCarty was instructed by Ferneithy survivors to do her own research, and that may be one of the reasons why. But they both looked at the same material. And you know, I've looked in detail at Diane McCaddy's report as well. But the fundamental issues that I have put in front of the committee this morning around the core purpose of the scheme, as agreed unanimously, and the need for that scheme to be allowed to get on to support those in the many hundreds of cases that it is dealing with, and the second about the evidential requirements, I think we can't get beyond the fact that you could, you know, be looking at thousands and thousands and thousands of people who had a few weeks at a potential institution, who had a few weeks, who were placed in Ferneithy, but many other institutions who would not have the evidential requirements to come in front of a scheme. That would raise expectations for thousands of people when they would not be able to bring the evidence in front of the scheme. And I'm afraid we can't get beyond the fact that those records don't exist for people at Ferneithy or the many other similar institutions that were there at the time.
Thank you. Maurice Golden.
Thank you, convener. I'm actually quite shocked at what I've heard. I think for the victims, it's, in my view, completely irrelevant whether there was unanimity in the Scottish Parliament. I think it's completely irrelevant whether the scheme in Scotland is far broader. And it's completely irrelevant whether there's thousands and thousands of cases that need to be addressed. Because in my view, one victim is too many. And I just wonder, parking all the parliamentary protocol, if you think it's acceptable the way these victims have been treated.
I think what has happened, as I said in my opening statement to for Nethi survivors, is what happened to them was appalling. I reiterated very much the recognition of that. I also reiterated the former Deputy First Minister's apology that was given to people in any setting, no matter the redress scheme that came after that. He was very clear that there was an apology to people in any setting whatsoever, whether or not the redress scheme was then set up to cover those areas or not. And I absolutely reiterate that, every word of it. That's a different matter to the redress scheme and who is covered in terms of eligibility. And that's a different matter to the evidential requirements that the redress scheme has. But from me, as the Deputy First Minister and on behalf of the First Minister, we absolutely recognise and believe what has happened here and absolutely recognise the harm that has happened to not just those in Ferneti, but elsewhere as well.
What are you going to do about it?
So I am aware that there are some litigation cases going on with Glasgow City Council. I'm also aware that there's a criminal case ongoing, which I can't obviously comment upon because it's a live case. And I have gone and reiterated very much the apology that was given by my predecessor. And actually, you know, I know that for people who are in this position, that recognition is actually sometimes the most important thing, to be honest. In terms of other supports, you know, we have got support for survivors who have been through some of the absolutely appalling experiences that they have through some of the support networks. I know that some Ferneti survivors have accessed some of that, and that is provided through the In Care Future Pathways. And again, you know, that has been established in order to recognise that people will need that support. Some people will want to access support like that. And you know, we need to wait to, you know, in terms of the litigation cases, again, I can't comment. I have written to Glasgow City Council this morning, actually, to bring to their attention the fact that these two reports exist. And I know that the Ferneti survivors have made a number of demands of Glasgow City Council. I can't obviously instruct Glasgow City Council around these matters, but I have drawn to their attention the reports that are in existence.
Thanks for that. What action has been taken to support those who were abused in short-term holiday care, enabling them to access some form of redress?
Well, in terms of the action, is the essentially we have established the research project was my way of trying to get to the bottom of whether there were records that existed that could look at the barriers around parental connections and parental consent. And the issue, of course, of records existing that showed someone was within an establishment at a particular time. That was done with the very purpose of trying to get to the bottom of what may or may not exist in the archives. Beyond that, as I've alluded to, there are support networks provided by the likes of Future Pathways that can support people who have experienced abuse in any setting, and that has been established with that purpose. It might not be for everyone, not everyone would want to access such support, but it's been established for the purpose of for those who do want to provide that support going forward.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister.
Fergus Hughan, have you any further questions? Oliver Wendell.
The
Deputy First Minister had said before, she had records of when Fergus Ewing and I were on the Education Committee, and I just wondered in that bundle if she had the official report from Thursday the 12th of January 2023, because I can read to you what the what your predecessor said at that, and he said, "I've listened carefully to the group that has made representations to me, all the members of which are Finethi survivors and are part of the wider group. I do not believe, as things stand, that there is an inherent impediment to applications to the redress scheme coming forward from people who spent time at Finethi. I acknowledge that the nature of the environment in which individuals were spending their time at Finethi could be considered to fall within the ambit of the scheme, so I do not think there is an inherent impediment to applications coming forward and being considered. To put it slightly more bluntly, I reject the idea that the scheme is not for Finethi survivors. I think it is possible for Finethi survivors to be successful in applying under the scheme." And he goes on to say, looking at this issue around kind of local parentis, if you want to put it that way, that he doesn't believe that the situation at Finethi matches up with what you say. He says, "If a young person was at a holiday camp and was dropped off and picked up by their parents, it would be difficult to substantiate the view that the state was exercising responsibility. However, I do not think that the situation at Finethi ticks that rather neat middle box. If I may say so, that I've just outlined to the committee, the more I understand about the situation at Finethi, the more I find it difficult to reconcile it with the idea of some kind of voluntary endeavour, and I think that the matter hinges on that point." So you've come here today and you've told us repeatedly, you know, that you're following what your predecessor who brought this legislation through was intending. There it is in black and white. You know, that's something quite different to what you've suggested today.
Well, what the Deputy First Minister has said, and of course he met with Finethi survivors, as have I, was essentially what I said at the beginning, that Finethi survivors could apply to the redress scheme, but the issue was likely to be what the evidence was then in front of the redress scheme, who are a panel who have to make decisions based on the evidence in front of them. That's why I instructed Dr. Fossey to do the research to establish whether they could access the scheme and whether or not the impediments to accessing the scheme on the basis of the parental consent issue and the lack of records provide the evidential base for someone to put their application
with due respect, at the point this has been being considered, the second most senior person in the Scottish Government believed that these people would be eligible to apply, and not just that, the more that they found out about the situation, the less credible they found the outcome of the report you're now pushing, you know, as providing closure. John Swinney did not, and his words are there, and I'm sure he can correct them if he's changed his mind since, but he did not accept the argument that this was, that the parents had chosen to take their children there as if it was a holiday camp.
He says that
people were effectively directed and put there, and that the state was involved in facilitating that, and probably in a lot of cases a little bit more. And I just find it very hard, because I think you're here now and you could push the envelope a little bit and open this back up so that some of these people stood a better chance of getting justice. I don't know why that's hard.
So first of all, I said earlier on, and I want to emphasise again, that I accept that the issue of parental consent was an issue of power and relationships, and whether or not someone was clear and given, you know, a consent form and it was explicit. I accept all of that is very opaque, to say the least, and the experiences of the women in terms of what their recollections were, and you know, are clear that, you know, parents may have been encouraged, you've said coerced. The evidence is not there either way, but I don't for a second dispute what the women have said about that matter. But the issue, though, comes down to this matter, that whether, in terms of what former Deputy First Minister said and what I'm saying, the redress panel, in looking at applications, would need to have some level of evidential requirement in order to process a case. Now, that might be possible if someone for Fornethy had various placements in other settings as well, they could potentially bring a case.
Do you accept there's a point where the evidence is actually sitting here today, is formed by this group, where if you have lots of people saying that the same thing happened to them, it starts to look quite unlikely. It starts to look quite unlikely that something different happened.
But I'm not disputing what the women are saying for a second. Let me be really, really clear. I believe absolutely what they're saying. What I'm saying to you, though, is that Redress Scotland require some evidence of someone being placed into a setting, and there is no record for anybody. And what I'm saying to you is that there potentially are thousands of people who could have been placed in Fornethy type institutions, and we would be saying that to the redress panel that there doesn't need to be any record of that person being in a Fornethy type institution.
We'd be saying to the redress panel exactly what Parliament and the previous Deputy First Minister and several MSPs said repeatedly through the process of the passage of the bill. If you come forward, your evidence, your testimony will be believed, it will be taken as fact. Well, and what we'd be saying to them is, you've got provision to make exceptional circumstances, and actually, if you join together the testimony and evidence from these hundreds of people, thousands of people, if you join that together, you can start to build a pretty accurate picture. Some of these people have, over the years, spoken to medical professionals, have spoken to other people. You know, these concerns existed before the redress scheme came into place. People didn't just appear and join survivor groups. They didn't just appear and interact with services across the country when they thought the redress was on offer. Well, there is a historical record of people. It might not be as good as the official records, but quite frankly, it's not people's fault that these organisations didn't keep good records and have destroyed what they have.
So I totally accept that it's nobody's fault that those records have, or certainly not the survivors' fault, that those records do not exist. I also absolutely accept what you're saying about survivors coming together. But Redress Scotland, in the way they operate, require someone who has been...
Redress Scotland work for you. They work for the government.
They have guidance
The guidance can change.
Well, people have to have confidence in the scheme. So someone bringing a claim to Redress Scotland, who has been in institutional care for many years, has to provide a level of evidence. Now, they actually, survivors find that quite difficult, and I acknowledge the difficulty there in doing so, but they have to provide that level of evidence.
How can I have confidence in the scheme, though, if it's not possible for people who the person who brought the scheme through thought, you know, wouldn't have a barrier to accessing it, can't then access it? So the confidence works both ways. And, you know, I think, you know, the challenge is, you know, that these records don't exist. But I think to say that there's insufficient evidence on the balance of probabilities to say that people were somewhere that they say they were, and that lots of other people say they were, on a basis that lots of people, you know, on a basis that lots of people seem to understand as being how those things worked at the time.
Redress Scotland, of course, are independent of the government. They're as enshrined in the legislation. People have to have confidence in the scheme. There's no scheme anywhere in the world that would operate on the basis of not requiring evidence to be presented to them. That no scheme operates like that at all. That process can be quite difficult for survivors, and I've had survivor representation to me directly that actually the process is quite difficult. But people have to have confidence in the scheme, that there is an evidential requirement that has to be given, and that records are produced. There are by exception, but by exception is on a case-by-case basis rather than
If you block people from even getting past go, they don't get to the case-by-case basis. And that's what's happening at the moment. People are not able to get to the case-by-case basis because of guidance, because of things that you're saying. That's stopping them from getting to the case-by-case basis.
But you would be raising expectations for people who would not have the records because they don't exist. The records don't exist.
I think, to be fair, people don't have any expectations.
Mr Mundell, can you let the Deputy First Minister finish? There's other members who would like to ask questions.
Well, I think, you know, as I said, Redress Scotland are independent of government. They have guidance that means that they can fairly assess each and every application that comes in front of them. They do ask for quite a degree of evidence, which, as I say, survivors have raised with me, can be quite intrusive and really quite difficult and upsetting and triggering and all of that. And I understand all of that. But for people to have confidence in the scheme, that is the level of evidential requirements that they ask for. The point I'm making, in the absence of any records for survivors at Fernethy or any of the other many Fernethy-type institutions, there are no such records to begin a basis of producing that evidence. And I think I have to be honest about that.
Mr Childrey.
Thank you, Convener. My apologies. Good morning, Deputy First Minister.
Good morning.
Can you change the regulation, even though the current position is not to change?
Well, there's technically, yes, but the point I'm making is that the core purpose of the scheme was set up, and this is my predecessor was really clear about this, to support those who had been in long-term care without any, where parental responsibility had been removed through social work legislation. That was the focus of the scheme. I've tried to set out the reasons why the confidence in the scheme as established is important. I've set out why the evidential requirements are there and for the reasons that those are important. And so it's not that it's not technically possible. What I've set out are the reasons that it would be very, very difficult to do.
If the Scottish Government is not planning to amend the current legislation to allow survivors to claim redress, will it provide funding to allow the survivors of Fernethy to pursue justice via legal means?
Well, obviously any legal advice that anyone receives needs to be independent legal advice around any potential litigation cases. There are litigation cases ongoing against Glasgow City Council. I can't comment on those because they're live. Similarly, there is a criminal case that is ongoing. I can't comment on that either because it's live. So there are, those routes are open. In terms of, any support that the government provides, we give, so I've talked about the support through the future pathways that is there to help survivors. And I've talked about the support that is also given around looking for case records. So the government provides resources, I think it's about 2.4 million to help survivors get records, and one of the reasons we did the piece of research was to try and address that issue because of the importance of records for Redress Scotland. So where survivors who have been in long-term care have had difficulty in accessing records, there is support there to help them do that because of the importance of that evidence being presented to Redress Scotland. As I say, that is the situation.
Thank you.
Small supplementary, Maurice Golden.
Thank you. I'm genuinely shocked by the independent of government argument. I worked for a Scottish Government-funded organisation, even though it was a private company, and there's literally nothing that we could do without approval of the Scottish Government. And it seems that the relationship is peculiarly different with respect to Redress Scotland. So is the Deputy First Minister seriously saying that there's nothing that she can do with regards to Redress Scotland standing up to the for the victims of Ferneithi?
Well, I'm not saying that at all. I'm saying that the eligibility criteria has been set with the exceptions clearly set out. So I'm not saying technically those exceptions could be changed, but what I've said here this morning is why I don't think that is the right approach, as was laid out in Parliament at the time, agreed unanimously, because the focus was on those who were in long-term care, removed from parental responsibility. In terms of the independence of Redress Scotland, the point I'm making there is in determination of decision-making around awards, it's quite right that that's independent of government. It wouldn't be right for us to be, you know, interfering in Redress Scotland's determination of individual cases. And they then look at those individual cases as a panel based on the evidential requirements that are set out in guidance. So that is the relationship. I don't know, do you want to come in, Lindsay?
Perhaps.
Sorry, do you want to come in?
Just to say that under Section 6 of the Act, it's clearly stated that in performing their functions under the legislation, Redress Scotland is not subject to the direction or control of any member of the Scottish Government, and that was deliberate at the time, and that was seen as an important safeguard for undue interference from government.
Martin Whitfield, a short statement, please. We are really, really pushed for time.
Can I thank the committee and you, convener, for allowing this, and it will be very short. There's been a lot of discussion that, with the greatest respect, is mixing up two elements. One is whether or not the survivors that brought this petition can enter the redress scheme, and then if they enter the redress scheme, the evidence that would be required to match with it. And I think it would be helpful to separate, and I understand from your answer to my colleague Faisal Chowdhury that it sits within ministers' power to change the regulations to allow entry into the redress scheme. And then once they're in the redress scheme, I think, as Oliver Mundell has pointed out, it would be for the evidence to be balanced. The First Minister has used the figure of 79% for those across Scotland that were in agreement with the remit of the redress scheme. Does the Deputy First Minister think that if people of Scotland understood this petition the way the petition committee does, the way those people who've attended today, 79% of Scotland say they shouldn't deserve redress?
Well, look, I, first of all, understand that, you know, people would have enormous empathy, I think, with the position of anyone who had suffered abuse in any setting. And, of course, there are a number of settings that are out with the eligibility, and I would have empathy with every single one of those who has suffered abuse in any of the settings, no matter whether they are part of the eligibility criteria or not. In terms of the consultation, and out of the consultation, 91% of those identified as a survivor of abuse in care. And I think the focus at the time was very much, as set out by the former Deputy First Minister, of getting a scheme up and running to address those who had been in long-term care out with parental, out taken away from parental responsibility. And that was the focus of the scheme. And Parliament, as I said, had looked at these matters, debated them at the time, and I think there was quite a difficult debate about where the line was drawn around what institutions, what areas would be included within the scheme and what would not. These were difficult decisions that were made at the time, and it excluded a number of settings, as I'm sure members around this table are aware. But having drawn that line, when you compare Scotland's redress scheme to every other scheme that I'm aware of, it is far broader and far more inclusive than many, many other schemes. And I just want to say this at the end. You know, I very much adhere to the apology that was given by the Deputy First Minister prior to the redress scheme. So before these debates were had and lines were drawn and eligibility criteria was set, that was the fundamental recognition that what had happened to anybody in any setting was absolutely wrong, and the recognition of the harm that that abuse has had on every single individual, leaving aside the eligibility. And I absolutely want to put on record again my recognition, my belief in what is being said, the belief of the truth of what people are saying, and the recognition of the harm. And I think, you know, I hope that that is recognised on behalf of the government. We absolutely recognise all of that and have huge sympathy and empathy with every single person.
Before we bring the session to a close, Deputy First Minister, is anything we haven't covered or you would like to put on record?
I don't think so, Convener, but if there's anything the committee wants to follow up on in any detail, then I'm happy to write to the committee with further evidence if you feel, once you have your discussion afterwards.
In that case, I would like to thank you for evidence, and members have agreed to consider evidence we have heard today in private, and we're content to do so. In that case, I would like to suspend the meeting for a short break to allow the witnesses to leave. Thank you. Can I welcome everyone back? Our next continued petition is petition 1865, suspend all surgical mesh and fixation devices, lodged by Rosanna Clarkin and Laura McDougall. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to suspend the use of all surgical mesh and fixation devices while a review of all surgical procedures which use polyester, polypropylene or titanium is carried out and guidelines for surgical use of mesh are established. We last considered this petition at our meeting on the 14th of June 2023 when we agreed to write to the Minister for Public Health and Women's Health and the British Hernia Society. As with previous considerations of this petition, we are joined by MSP colleagues Katie Clark and Claire Adamson, who is online, who joins us remotely. Since the last consideration, we have received submissions from Katie Clark with further details of FOI responses referred to during our previous consideration on a number of patients readmitted following complications with surgical mesh. The Minister for Public Health and Women's Health response tells us there is a subspecialist coverage in complex hernia repair, including non-mesh repair, operating in NHS Lothian, Fife and Grampian, with a further subspecialist base at the Golden Jubilee National Hospital. The Minister also provided an update on the development and implementation of a scan of safety programme, as well as indicating that further options for improved data collection, such as a registry of hernia repair procedures, are also being looked at by government officials and their NHS colleges. Reference was also made to a public awareness campaign, It's OK to Ask, which aims to support the patients and healthcare professionals having positive conversations about the care and treatment. We have a response from the British Hernia Society, which states it cannot support the suspension of all surgical mesh and fixation devices, as this would run counter to the best scientific evidence guidelines published by the European Hernia Society. The Society does not recognise the need to improve patient outcomes and offers information on the work being done to develop the hernia registry, which it hopes to roll out nationally this year. We have also received submissions from the petitioners responding to the British Hernia Society submission and highlighting that the improved patient pathways the Minister mentions has not so far led to improvements in the everyday experience of mesh patients. They are also concerned that little progress has been made to bridge the skills gap between natural tissue and mesh repair, and have highlighted a number of surgeons around the world who are developing their own non-mesh hernia techniques. One of the petitioners, Rosanna Clacton, has also shared her own experience of mesh-related complications and the barriers faced when requesting non-mesh repair. Members will also be aware that since our last consideration of this petition, that Parliament has passed the Patient Safety Commissioner of Scotland Act, enabling the establishment of a commissioner to advocate for systemic improvements in the safety of healthcare and to promote the importance of the views of patients and other members of the public in relation to safety of healthcare. Can I ask Katie Clark if you would like to put her submission first?
Thank you very much, and I'm very grateful to the committee. I appear on behalf of both petitioners, Rosanna Clarkin and Lauren McDougall. Rosanna Clarkin, who you've already spoken about, convener, continues to suffer from mesh-related complications and is attempting to obtain support both through the National Health Service and indeed through Social Security Scotland in relation to those. And there is a number of issues in relation to that, and she hopes that the mesh will eventually be removed, although there are some complications round about that. I also appear on behalf of Lauren McDougall, whose mother died, unfortunately, shortly after a hernia mesh procedure. And they both work with a number of campaigners who have been negatively impacted specifically by the use of mesh in hernia processes. They believe there remain a number of outstanding issues and that mesh is still used in many situations where alternatives could be used in hernia procedures. And therefore, I would focus on perhaps the second part of the petition relating to guidelines for the surgical use of mesh. I think it would be helpful if we could get more evidence in relation to current practice. And I would ask the committee to consider whether they would be willing to look at examples of current individuals who are receiving mesh in situations where they believe alternatives should have been considered and would be more appropriate, with a view to looking at the type of guidelines which perhaps could be created in Scotland.
Thank you. Claire Adamson, MSP.
Thank you. I trust you can hear me, convener.
Yes.
Thank you. I am very pleased that the committee has given me this opportunity to speak to the petition on behalf of my constituent, Miss Janet Weatherit. Miss Weatherit is one of many women whose life and livelihoods have been harmed by complications following mesh implants. She had two vaginal mesh devices fitted in 2012 and 2013, and since that time has had to endure chronic pain and been prescribed multiple medications. Her story speaks to the heart of the injustice faced by those who have suffered from mesh complications. Miss Weatherit travelled to the USA in August last year. She had a referral for surgery for mesh removal with Dr. Veronicus. The removal procedure was successful. However, Ms. Weatherit has suffered post-removal complications. She was advised at the time of the removal that she required medical repairs. Mr. Weatherit reported that Dr. Veronicus lamented that he could perform the repairs, quote, there and then, but this contract with the NHS only allowed for mesh removal, and any post-surgery repairs were not covered as part of the contract, and these would have to be done back in the UK. Ms. Weatherit was then advised through the National Services Division that the agreed position was that any post-removal reconstructive surgery would be undertaken in Scotland by local services. Questions remain over whether her aftercare can be done locally within NHS Lanarkshire or will require a further referral. Indeed, Ms. Weatherit's NHS Lanarkshire consultant has already raised issues around post-surgery care with the National Transvaginal Mesh Accountable Officers Group. Ms. Weatherit's case is emotive. She has been faced with intense uncertainty, still an unbearable pain, and delay and disappointment. While she's relieved the mesh is removed, she is still in need of medical help. In reference to the petition before the committee, I would ask that the Petitions Committee ensure that it prioritises a clear clinical pathway for mesh use and removal that sets out accurate expectations for those who require surgery or post-surgery care of repairs following removal from a funded provider with NHS Scotland. Ms. Weatherit is keen that those considering travelling for surgery are aware of her experience in order that they can make a fully informed decision with regards to the decision to go ahead with mesh removal out with Scotland. She also wishes that her experience informs the committee as they deliberate on this petition before them. I have taken up whether it's concerns with both NHS Lanarkshire and the Minister, but convener, women affected by mesh deserve her continued support and care. Indeed, everyone affected by mesh deserves that, and not just for the past, but for their present and future, to ensure that they have the best possible outcomes and quality of life. And I thank the committee for the opportunity to speak to the petition this morning.
Can I thank Katie Clark, MSP, and Claire Adams, MSP, for your statements. Members, do we have any comments or suggestions for action? Morris.
Thank you, convener. I think we should write to the Cabinet Secretary for NHS Recovery, Health and Social Care, setting out the evidence the committee has gathered to date, including today, from what we have heard from Katie Clark and Claire Adamson, and recommend that he meet with the petitioners to discuss continuing concerns about patient pathways for those harmed by mesh implants, and the work undertaken to bridge the skills gap between natural tissue and mesh repair in Scotland. I also think we could perhaps follow up with the Scottish Parliament corporate body to seek details of the process and timeline for recruiting the Patient Safety Commissioner.
Thank you, Pat. Are members of the committee agreed? Agreed. Thank you. Can I say thank you to Claire Adamson and Katie Clark. Our next continued petition is petition 1953, Review Educational Support Staff Roles, lodged by Rosalind Taylor-Young. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to review education support staff roles in order to consider urgently raising wages for education support staff across the primary and secondary sector to £26,000 per annum. Increase hours of the working day for educational support staff from 27.5 to 35 hours. Allowing educational support staff to work on personal learning plans with teachers, take part in multi-agency meetings, and requiring educational support staff to register with the Scottish Social Services Council and paying educational support staff monthly. We last considered this petition at our meeting on the 31st of May 2023, where we agreed to seek an update on the Bute House Agreement commitment to explore options for the development of an accredited qualification and registration programme for additional support needs assistance. Recent response from Cabinet Secretary states that the report had been intended for consideration by ministers in autumn 2023, but the work has been delayed due to competing priorities within the portfolio. The report is now due to be published in the first quarter of 2024. The submission reports that officials have engaged with counterparts in England and Wales on their approaches to this work and hosted two online workshops in September 2023. Do members have any comments or suggestions? Maurice Golding.
Thank you. I think we should write to the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills seeking an update on the Bute House Agreement Exploration Group's recommendations and information about what she expects the next steps will be.
Members agreed? Thank you. Our next continued petition is petition 1960, formally recognises private hire, car and taxis as modes of public transport. Lodged with Edward Grice on behalf of the Scottish Private Hire Association. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to formally recognise that private hire cars and taxis as modes of public transport and to enshrine such recognition in law. We last considered this petition at our meeting on the 31st of May 2023 when we agreed to write to the Traffic Commissioner for Scotland. The Office of the Traffic Commissioner response notes that legislative definition of a public vehicle sets out in the Public Passengers of Vehicle Act 1981, which generally includes vehicles designed to carry eight or more passengers for hire or reward. Holders of a taxi or private hire licences can apply for a special restricted operator's licence if they intend to use a vehicle for the provision of a local bus service. The response notes that there are 34 holders of special restricted operator's licence in Scotland. With the Scottish Government having previously suggested there is no universal legal definition of public transport, with different transport modes subject to their own specific legislation, meaning there is no obvious route to enshrine a definition in law. Do members have any comments or suggestions? Maurice Golding.
Thank you. I think we should close the petition under Rule 15.7 of the Standing Orders on the basis that the Scottish Government has previously stated that there is no universal legal definition of public transport and each transport mode is subject to specific legislation. And there is no obvious legislation that could be amended to enshrine a definition in law and set out the relationship between the different transport sectors and local and national government.
Thank you. Fergus Hugh.
Yes, I don't demur from that recommendation, Convener, but could I perhaps just add that my understanding of Mr. Grice's petition here is that his main beef, his main grouse, his main complaint was that private hire and taxis, and there's a lot of them and they're very important, are really not involved in the sort of club of policy making, either at local authority or at national level. They feel excluded from that. Now, his solution was to classify them as a form of public transport, and I think perhaps that's just not the right solution. But I just wanted to say in the record that, you know, I do think that they need to be better informed, involved in discussing policy regarding transport. Whether or not they're public transport, they are transporting the public, and they're really very, very important that their voice is heard when it comes to policy, particularly with LEZs with the requirement to upgrade taxis to comply with regulations. There's never been a time when taxi drivers are under more financial pressure than now. So I just wanted to put that on the record, Convener, in case Mr. Grice, who I believe is a frequent petitioner, might want to think again about perhaps framing his request with a different objective, which might better achieve his aim of being part of the system of consultation about transport matters.
Can I say thank you for that, Mr. Ewan? I do know that the taxi federations in Fife are really engaged with regulations and licence, and they have their taxi forums which deal with all that. So I just wonder if it's an example which other 32 local authorities and taxi drivers can engage with. Are we happy with Mr. Golden's recommendations?
Yes, happy with them. I just concur with Fergus Ewing's comments there, because I think in large parts of rural Scotland as well, taxis and private hire cars are what amounts to public transport. They're ferrying people to hospital appointments, and they provide a lifeline in the absence of bus services. So I can certainly understand the petitioner's aim, but I don't think it's possible to fulfil the outcome.
Thank you for that, members. Our next continued petition is Petition 1961, make it a specific offence to assault, threaten or abuse a private hire or taxi driver while at work, also lodged by Edward Grice on behalf of the Scottish Private Hire Association. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to expand the protection of workers, retail and age-restricted goods and services, Scotland Act 2021, to include private hire and taxi drivers, by creating a specific criminal offence for assaulting, threatening or abusing private hire or taxi drivers while they are engaged in private hire or taxi work, and considering such offence as aggravated when the offence is committed whilst the driver is enforcing a licensing or operational condition. We last considered this petition at our meeting on the 31st of May 2023, when you agreed to write to the Scottish Government. We have received a response from the Minister for Victims and Community Safety, which notes that the provision of the 2021 Act complete a range of general criminal laws which protect everyone from abuse and violence, with the penalties for these offences being greater than the maximum penalties available under the 2021 Act. The Minister also confirms that the Scottish Government is not considering legislation to extend the provision of the 2021 Act to include private hire drivers, taxi drivers or transport workers in general. Given the Scottish Government's clear position, do members have any comments and suggestions? Maurice Golden.
Thank you. I think we should close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that, firstly, the types of behaviour referenced in the position may already be prosecuted under common law and existing statutory offences. That said, this Parliament has established a legal precedence in amending or going beyond common law in certain cases. However, the Scottish Government has confirmed there is no plans to extend the Protection of Workers, Retail and Age-Restricted Goods and Services Scotland Act 2021 to include private hire drivers, taxi drivers or transport workers in general. And, Convener, may I say to the petitioner that given that there is that legal precedence, I don't believe the committee can take any further regard, but individual member could look to introduce a member's bill to develop the legal precedence as per the Act that I've previously mentioned.
Thank you, Mr. Golden, for that. Are members of the committee agreed? Thank you. Our next continued petition is Petition 2016, Raise Awareness of Thrombosis in Scotland, lodged by Gordon McPherson. Petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to raise awareness of the risk factors, signs and symptoms of thrombosis. We last considered the petition at our meeting on the 14th of June 2023. At a meeting we heard that recent research by the British Medical Journal shows that after COVID-19 infection there is an increased risk of DVT for up to 3 months, pulmonary embolism for up to 6 months and bleeding event for up to 2 months after an infection. With that in mind, we agreed to seek a view as to whether it may be necessary to undertake more work to raise awareness of thrombosis. The Scottish Government's response stated that it is considering the issue highlighted by research and is looking at what further awareness messaging can be undertaken via social media. On the figures, it explained that the PQ answer referred to by the petitioner in previous submissions includes all conditions that are all mostly due to blood clot forming in that location, including both arteries and veins. This therefore includes some of the most common causes of death, including myocardial infarction and stroke. The data used in response to a petition relates clots forming in the veins and includes instances where these travel and cause pulmonary embolisms. The petitioner's recent submissions notes that his petition covers thrombosis as a whole, rather than specific subdiversions. He states that the sign has worked on the guideline which highlights the link between COVID-19 and blood clots, but that no action has been taken by the Scottish Government to raise awareness. Due to that, do any members have any comments or suggestions? Fergus Ewan.
Yes, I think we should write to the Cabinet Secretary for Health to seeking confirmation of whether the Scottish Government is undertaking any work to raise awareness of thrombosis, and if not, why not? And also for his view on whether it's necessary to undertake more work to raise awareness of thrombosis in the light of the BMJ's research, the British Medical Journal's research, which connects COVID-19 with an increased risk of thrombosis and pulmonary embolisms. And making that request, I do think that it might be useful to allude in the letter to specifically to the evidence that we've received. Plainly, Mr. McPherson has suffered greatly. I mean, he lost his daughter. It's an absolute tragedy. And he's also provided very detailed information which conflicts with the Scottish Government information. He said that there was, I think, from memory, 11,400 cases. The Scottish Government's figure was vastly lower. And I don't think we've really bottomed out the difference. And that seems to me to be very, very important, because if he's right and they're wrong, then we need to do an awful lot more than we're doing at the moment. And I would just also point out to Jackie Bailey's representation for Mr. McPherson, which was highly useful to the committee and which I think would be useful for the Cabinet Secretary, who I know takes these things extremely seriously, to peruse for himself. I just wanted to say that to underscore the importance of the matters that Mr. McPherson has raised, and hope that the Cabinet Secretary gets that when he gets the letter and perhaps a copy of the official report of this meeting.
Do we agree with Mr. Ewan's recommendations? Thank you. Our next continued petition is Petition 2018, recognises the value of swimming pools and provides financial relief to help keep swimming pools open, lodged by Helen Plank on behalf of the Scottish Swimming. Petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to help keep our swimming pools and leisure centres open by providing financial investment for pools. I welcome another of my MSP colleagues, Tim Eagle, to the committee. As a new addition to the Parliament, we are pleased to see him as he takes an interest in the public petitions process, and welcome Mr. Eagle.
Thank you very much for that, convener. It's a pleasure to be here, actually, at my first one, and thanks to the clerks for helping me come. I just wanted to speak to this, and thanks to Scottish Swimming, obviously, and Liz Smith, MSP, who's put in her letter of support for this as well. This is something that came up during my time as a councillor, which is, you know, the grassroots level of politics in Scotland, about the financial struggles around sport and health overall, and the financial struggles that some of the councils are having. The problem with it is that health and leisure facilities aren't ring-fenced, and so budgets are easy to cut when you have got to protect what are very important things like education, adult health and social care, etc. However, the problem I've always faced with this, and why I was quite strong on this in the council, is we are an island nation. We have some beautiful lochs and rivers throughout our country, and swimming is a very popular and increasingly popular activity. And the risk is that we are already, I think, double the UK average in terms of deaths, accidental drownings. That could go up if we shut more. Now, particularly as we've got a lot of rural areas in the country, rural connectivity isn't great. We've got bus routes which are limited, and so getting access to swimming pools, if you start closing them, gets harder and harder. And I just wanted to bring, I know a lot of this is already in a lot of the report, but I just wanted to commend those things. Swimming is invaluable in preventative medicine, and I think as we talk about health moving forward, I think that's going to become more and more something we should discuss. And so I just really feel that we need to have a stronger discussion with the Scottish Government about how we can help councils to protect these very important facilities.
Thank you, Mr. Eagle. We last considered the petition at our meeting on the 14th of June 2023, when we agreed to write to the Minister for Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport, and Sport Scotland. Sport Scotland responded to further details on support it provided to Scottish Swimming Facilities Project, which is being taken forward in three phases by Scottish Swimming, who have lodged this petition. The Minister for Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport confirmed that the Scottish Government received Barnett Consequentials of £1.939 million resources and a £3.877 million capital funding following the UK Government's announcing in spring 2023 of a swimming pool fund. As Barnett Consequentials do not require to be allocated to a policy area that they have resulted from, and the Minister has not offered any indication of where this money was allocated, it remains unclear whether additional funding was in fact used to support swimming facilities in Scotland. We also have received a submission from a petitioner which includes a link to a report on the future of swimming facilities in Scotland and notes the number of pools which have closed since the petition was lodged and the impact of this on the local communities. Our MSP colleague Liz Smith is unable to join us in person today, but has provided a written statement in support of this petition. And Mr Eagles has already given his statement, so do members have any comments or recommendations? Mr Chowdhury?
Thank you. I think we I would like to welcome Tim. It's your, good to see you here. I've been involved with that as well before, and I do think that the presentation, if given by our colleague, is great. And I think we do need to recognise, and you know how the swimming pools are closing, West Lothian, there is three swimming pools recently closed as well, and I have a lot of constituents who is asking what support is the government providing. I think we should write to the Minister of Social Care again for mental health and wellbeing and sports to seek the Scottish Government's response to the future of swimming facilities in Scotland report and seek further details on the financial support being provided or for swimming facilities.
Thank you, Mr. Chowdhury. Ferguson?
Yeah, I support Mr. Chowdhury has recommended, and would just add that, just to highlight the fact that the petitioner in his very recent submission of the 7th of March has pointed out that since the petition was lodged, which I think was April last year, fairly short period of time really, six swimming pools have closed, 147 swimming pools are at risk, and that 95% of the population in Scotland think that pools are important for safety. So in light of that, plus the wide concerns from Liz Smith, from Tess White, from Fulton McGregor, who did some work early on with the petitioner, I believe, according to the petitioner, and the fact, as you remarked, Convener, that apparently the Scottish Government received Barnett Consequentials of nearly £2 million in resource and nearly £4 million in capital. I mean, I think people are entitled to know what's happened to that money. And I understand we don't have to use it for swimming pools, but, I mean, if we don't, how many more swimming pools are going to close over the next year? So I think we need some straight answers, and we didn't get that from the Minister's response. I mean, it was opaque. In the extreme. So, as you can tell, Convener, I'm not entirely satisfied with the Scottish Government's approach in this case.
Thank you, Mr. Ferguson. Can I any other further comments from members?
I did ask a few questions on this as well, and I did agree. I do agree with Fergus that we are not getting any straight answer from the government. I think we should write.
With that, we will write to the Minister for Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport to ask him what additional funding has been given and to see if the Barnett Consequentials have been passed over for swimming pools. Is that agreed?
Yes.
Paul Sweeney. Paul. Our final continued petition is Petition 1906, Investigate Options for Moving and Reducing the Impact of Central Glasgow Section of the M8, lodged by Peter Kelly on behalf of Replace the M8. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to commission an independent feasibility study to investigate scenarios for reducing the impact of the M8 between the M74 and Glasgow Caffarandrill including specifically complete removal and repurposing of the land. We're joined in our consideration of this petition by MSP colleague Paul Sweeney, and a warm welcome to you, Mr. Sweeney. We last considered this petition at our meeting on the 31st of May, 2023. The petitioner has provided a submission which notes actions of his group wishes the committee to follow up on, including their ask of an independent study to be commissioned. Councillor Angus Miller has written to the committee on behalf of Glasgow City Council, confirming a strategic and operational approach being taken by a local authority. And Councillor Miller highlights a paper which sets out the Council's progress, the action taken and the proposed next steps. An extract from that paper is available in the petitions paper and breaks down a number of issues the Council wishes to explore in the short, medium and long term. It outlines engagements between the Council and Transport Scotland, with a note that the annual progress meeting between the Council and Transport Scotland officers was agreed to and over and above interim discussions. It is also proposed that the action plan be prepared to cover the Council's projects that interact with M8 between junctions 15 and 22. This plan would work to identify the role of Transport Scotland in these interventions and to help facilitate, collaborate and progress. Before I invite members to comment, can I ask Paul Sweeney to make a comment, please?
Yeah, thank you very much, Convener, and it's a pleasure to be back before the committee on such an interesting petition, which has elicited significant public interest, most recently in a BBC Radio 4 documentary called Motorway City by the journalist Alan Little, which covered in great detail the history of the construction of the Glasgow Inner Ring Road and the historic development and the current challenges facing it. Certainly the correspondence from Glasgow City Council is encouraging, and that they have established a working relationship with Transport Scotland as the statutory agency that is the owner of the trunk road infrastructure through Glasgow, to look at options for mitigations. There are certain discrete ideas that members of the public and other stakeholders, and certainly the petitioner and adjacent activists, have proposed around rationalisation of certain slip roads and capping and so on, which are worth further investigation. And I wonder if it might be feasible for the committee to consider inviting the officials from Transport Scotland to ultimately report to the Scottish ministers and indeed to this parliament to further elaborate on their perspectives on what options are available. And also perhaps the Transport Minister might want to come before the committee to set out their position with how they propose to work with Glasgow City Council to investigate some of these particular options. And that might allow for greater transparency and public awareness and scrutiny of what is going on through this Parliament. If the members of the committee were minded to consider those proposed actions, I think that would be a really positive development for this petition and would anchor the Parliament's role in this much more securely.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Sweeney. Do members have any comments or recommendations? Morris?
Thank you. I appreciate the comments that Paul Sweeney's made, and actually it's I think beneficial that the committee's heard that the progress regarding this petition is being made, and because of that I feel that the committee should close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that Glasgow City Council has committed to progress the issues raised in the petition, including commissioning research on and exploring options to reduce the impact of the M8 on the city centre, and reviewing opportunities to re-engineer other roads infrastructure to become more people-friendly, including options for long-term replacement. And indeed, Transport Scotland is engaging with Glasgow City Council on its work and will hold an annual progress meeting in addition to interim discussions on specific actions.
Members agreed? Can I just remind the petitioner that if the progress doesn't move as fast as it does with Glasgow City Council and Transport Scotland, that they can bring a petition back to the committee after a year? Thank you. We now move on to agenda item 3, consideration of new petitions. Before I introduce our first new petition, I should begin by highlighting to those following today's proceedings that a considerable amount of work is done in advance of a consideration of a petition. Before a petition's first consideration, an initial view is sought from the Scottish Government and a briefing from the Parliament's Impartial Research Service is provided. Our first new petition is Petition 2063, Increased Funding for Local Authorities to Enable Better Management and Protect the Conservation Areas, lodged by David Walsh, Park Preservation's Patrons. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to provide additional funding to all local authorities in Scotland, enabling them to better manage and protect the character and appearance and designated conservation areas. Paul Sweeney has remained with us for a considering of his new petition. The petitioner notes that historic conservation areas throughout Scotland are falling into disrepair, and while he recognises the financial challenges facing both national and local government, requests that the Scottish Government addresses a specific concern being raised regarding funding for conservation areas. The SPIFE briefing provides information on the planning process that apply to conservation areas, while noting that the responsibility for upkeep of land and buildings within conservation areas rests with the owners. The Scottish Government refers to its response to a local government settlement and the policy of allowing local authorities the financial freedom to allocate the resources available to them. The response goes on to note the support and guidance available via Historic Environment Scotland to help promote and protect the historic environment. Before I go to the Committee for Recommendations, can I ask Paul Sweeney if he would like to make a statement?
Thank you very much, Convener. And it's a pleasure to address the members of the Committee on this particular petition. I've been in correspondence with the petitioner over the last few months in relation to some issues they've had around enhancement to the park conservation area in the west end of Glasgow, which speaks to a broader issue around improving the guidance and regulations around conservation areas and the obligations on local authorities. Their particular idea was to reinstate heritage-style lampposts and various other improvements to the area, but there wasn't, in their view, sufficient support or capacity to help them achieve their objectives. Similarly, there has been concerns that roads authorities and other utilities can summarily come in and scar historic streetscapes, can remove street furniture which is of a historic nature, and undertake similar interventions without any real statutory enforcement or oversight. And perhaps in light of some of these flaws in the current legislation as set out in the Planning Listed Buildings and Conservation Areas Scotland Act of 1997 and some of its adjacent legislation such as the Buildings Scotland Act of 2003, there is an opportunity for this committee to consider inviting stakeholders to feed in on this question and to establish whether there is reasonable grounds for improvements to the current legislation or indeed supplementary guidance. There have been, certainly in my interactions with a number of stakeholders, concerns that the regulations around conservation areas aren't sufficiently robust and that there's significant opportunity to establish best practice or at least to communicate where best practice is being achieved to other parts of the country. So to that, I would suggest that perhaps Historic Environment Scotland, the Architectural Heritage Society of Scotland, Save Britain's Heritage, the Glasgow Building Preservation Trust and Glasgow City Heritage Trust might be reasonable stakeholders to approach in the first instance to invite to feed into this exercise and perhaps allow us to establish whether there are opportunities for further improvements to the current legislation. I should in that instance declare an interest as a trustee of Glasgow City Heritage Trust in this proposal. But I think it would be a well worthwhile way for the committee to move this petition forward.
Sweeney, do members have any suggestions for actions? Fergus Ewan.
I'm grateful to Mr. Sweeney for outlining a little bit more colour and information and detail about what's behind this petition. The petition itself, however, simply calls on additional funding to be provided. It doesn't say how much, and it doesn't say what for, which is perhaps a bit unfortunate because it's a bit lacking in focus, I think. But be that as it may, I mean, the response we've had is from Glasgow councillors, they don't have the money for this, and frankly, that doesn't particularly surprise me with the local authorities facing the pressures that they do, and that does seem to be the reality of the situation. So given that and the lack of specificity, I would propose, convener, that to close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that it is the responsibility of local authorities to manage their own budgets and to allocate the total financial resources available to them on management and protection of conservation areas, and also that responsibility for upkeep of land or buildings in conservation area does rest with the owners.
Do members agree with Mr. Chowdhury?
As highlighted in the SPICE briefing, the Scottish Government has not taken any significant recent action in additional funding for the maintenance or enhancement for conservation areas. Can we ask the Scottish Government if it has any plan to release additional funding?
Mr. Golden?
Thank you. I support Mr. Ewing's suggestion of closing the petition, but I think what might be helpful for the petitioner is, if they so wish, to look at, in due course, coming back with a more, if you like, focused petition around the better management and protection of conservation areas, because with regards to increasing funding for local authorities, even if the Scottish Government were to do that, there is no requirement on said local authority to then focus that on the better management and protection of conservation areas. So I feel it's unfortunate for the committee and the petitioner in this instance, but I feel that closing the petition is the only thing we can do under these circumstances.
Is the committee agreed to this? Mr. Mundell?
Yeah, no, I was going to say I'm agreed, and I actually think we get a better quality of response, because the reality is, on the current premise, if we were to contact organisations or local authorities, we're going to move into what I think is quite a political space, you know, around funding rather than on something constructive. And I think that that's, you know, I think that, you know, that that's, this committee works best from my own limited experience of it when there is a defined kind of goal or something that's achievable at the end of the petition.
Mr. Chowdhury, are you willing to go with the rest of the committee's recommendations?
Well, I think if the majority is in favour of closing, but I still do think that that we should, because since the Scottish Government hasn't done anything at all on this, if they have any plans at all.
If you're not willing to withdraw, I have to go to a vote, Mr. Chowdhury.
Well,
okay, right. Okay, I've just been told that we can close the petition, but also write to the Scottish Government to see about additional funding for it. If that's just what the members are agreed with, I am more than happy to go with it. Are we all agreed? Thank you for that. Our next new petition is Petition 2067, Improved Data on Young People Affected by a Condition Causing Sudden Cardiac Death, lodged by Sharon Duncan. Petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to commission research to establish how many young aged 14 to 35s are affected by a condition that causes a young sudden cardiac death, clarify the number of people who die annually in Scotland from these conditions, and set up a pilot study to establish if voluntary screening can reduce deaths. Members will be aware that a petition has been lodged by a mother of parliamentary staffer, David Hill, tragically passed away while playing in an inter-parliamentary rugby match 2 years ago, almost to the day on the 19th of March 2022. And I understand that members of her family have joined us in the public gallery, and we extend our condolences and a warm welcome to you. As the petition notes, there is currently no screening programme for young people with conditions putting them at risk of sudden cardiac death. Despite the briefing we have received also notes that there are difficulties, such as the ways deaths are classified, and research that focuses on athletes rather than general population, and reaching agreement on the number of young people affected by sudden cardiac death. In responding to the ask of a petitioner, the Minister for Public Health and Women's Health notes government funding provided to the West of Scotland Inherited Cardiac Condition Services and the Network for Inherited Cardiac Conditions to deliver a sudden cardiac death project. With a focus on improving clinical pathways for families and enhancing data quality. The Minister has also made inquiries to UK National Screening Committee about plans to review its position on the population screening for conditions associated with sudden cardiac death in the young. We have also received a submission from a petitioner, Mrs Duncan, emphasising the importance of understanding the incidence of these conditions to develop treatments and pathways. Mrs Duncan also seeks clarity on the coding used for informed data on incidents and highlights that no account is taken of deaths such as David's where a cause of death is registered as a natural cause, despite post-mortem and follow-ups confirming a previous undiagnosed genetic cardiac decision. On that, do members have any comments and suggestions? Oliver Mundell.
Thank you very much, Convener. I should say I know David's family well, and it is lovely to see them in the gallery. And you know, I have the utmost admiration for Sharon, his mother, who, through very difficult circumstances, has sought to see what she can do to help other families. And you know, I see some of the stuff in the Spice briefing, but I think it, for me, comes back to a point Mr. Ewing made in relation to a previous petition. You know, what if Sharon Duncan and the wider Hill family are right? What if some of the organisations they're working with are right? And what if the screening committee is wrong? And I certainly know that if it was my child, you know, I would want to know that that question had been exhausted. So I would be keen for the committee to write to organisations with a kind of relevant interest to cry cardiac risk in the young, to Save a Life for Scotland, to the British Heart Foundation, to St John Scotland, to Chest, Heart and Stroke Scotland, and seek their views and expertise on what's called for in the petition and to find out about any work they may be undertaking in relation to conditions affecting sudden cardiac death. I'd also be keen that the committee write to the UK National Screening Committee to ask when it expects to review the evidence for screening for sudden cardiac death, and to write to the Network for Inherited Cardiac Conditions seeking further details and an update on its sudden cardiac death project. And in addition to that, you know, I'd be keen to go back to the Scottish Government. I know they've provided quite a helpful response in relation to this petition, but I would be keen to interrogate further their role in informing the National Screening Committee's work, because I think it's one thing to be kind of asking questions and making some representations, but you know, I don't know how much more they can do. I think there are certainly the Hill family, David Hill's family, and Sharon Duncan's mother. I mean, they're not in a unique position. There are families like this, you know, in every part of Scotland, and we've seen that through activities that have been undertaken in the Parliament since David's death, and those people, you know, I think at the least deserve us to try and get to the bottom of how this process works, you know, and be absolutely sure that all of the evidence has been taken into consideration.
Thank you for that, Mr. Mundell. Do members agree with Ferguson?
I entirely agree with everything that Oliver Mundell has just said, and I do think that as he said, the Minister Jenny Minto did give a rather fuller, more useful reply than some of the replies we get. So I think that should be acknowledged. But there are many, many complex issues raised here. But I just wanted to make one point on the record that the SPICE document we've got and refers to a UK government blog as reasons why there shouldn't be a screening programme. And that includes that some people might be unnecessarily anxious or the false reassurance might be provided or encouragement to get treatments which may be inappropriate. I did think that reply was just... I felt uneasy about that reply because there must be many screening programmes where there are perhaps not that many people who are going to be detected as having a particular problem for which the screening is designed, but that doesn't mean that you don't have screening. So I think those arguments, I just wanted to put on the record, those arguments seem to me to be very weak and perhaps pretty offensive, actually, to people who have lost a loved one because of this. And therefore, you know, I do hope the Minister can take that into account. And In addition, therefore, to the points that Mr. Mandela has raised, could we ask for more information at a high level of what screening programmes are undertaken to find out if some are undertaken where there's a serious risk of death, but actually not many people, statistically speaking, in the population are at risk?
Thank you for Mr. Yoon. Mr. Chowdhury?
I agree with both of my colleagues, but I understand that UK National Screening Committee is conducting a review and that the next review is expected to be completed in 2024. Do we know when exactly in 2024, and will we be informed of the recommendations of the reviews?
Thank you for that. With all these recommendations, are the committee agreed?
Yep.
Thank you. Thank you for attending today. Our next new petition is petition 2068, review the cap of public sector senior management salaries, lodged by John Dare. Petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to commission an independent review of public sector salaries over 100,000 per annum and introduce an appropriate cap. Despite briefing explains that the Scottish Government's public sector pay policy directly affects around 10% of those working in the public sector, and that large parts of the public sector pay are determined separately of what is often in line with the Scottish Government public sector pay policy. The Scottish Government's response to the petition states that they pay restraints for the highest paid and targeted uplifts for the lowest paid have been central to its approach to pay for many years. The submission notes that in recent years, progressive pay awards have capped uplifts above a threshold of 80,000. And that an interval review of the Chief Executive Framework is currently being undertaken. The review is due to conclude in spring 2024. Do members have any comments or suggestions on actions to take? Ferguson?
I do think that this, as a new petition, I do think it raises extremely serious points of principle that have concerned a great many people, including myself, for a long period of time, because, as the petitioner's essential argument is, there are vast numbers of people in the public sector that are paid in excess of £100,000. There are many people who are doing various jobs, and I think I'll mention any of them particularly, although some are going through my mind, who get paid far more than the First Minister. And we really wonder if the balance has somehow gone seriously askew. So, you know, because it's a new petition, because it's raised, I think, an issue of considerable public interest, especially at a time of real financial pressures, where it's quite hard to explain to people why a chief executives are very often the most invisible people in an organisation you can't actually get to meet or see. So I've better not name any, I'll get myself into trouble. But I do think that the reply we've got from the Scottish Government is just completely hopeless. I mean, it just doesn't answer the point at all. And this isn't going to go away. I personally find the level of salaries paid to some people in quangos to be incomprehensible. So, I hope I've made my position reasonably clear, but I do think we should keep this open and write to the Scottish Government to demand a little bit more substance to the reply. And if they're ever going to tackle this problem, or do we just basically accept it and throw it as it is, warts and all, and obvious injustice though there is.
Thank you for your comments, Mr. Yoon. Do members agree with that?
I wouldn't dare not disagree with it.
On that note, we'll move to the next petition. Our next new petition is petition 2070, Stop Same Day Only GP Appointment Systems, lodged by Lorraine Russo. Petition calls on the Scottish Government to urge the Scottish Government to stop GP surgeries from only allowing same-day appointment bookings, enabling patients also to make appointments for future dates. Despite recent highlights, the 2021-22 Health and Care Experience Survey, which reported a sharp drop in the percentage of people finding it easy to contact their GP practice in the way that they want to. It also notes that NHS England made changes to the 2023-24 GP contract, make clear that patients should be offered an assessment of need or signposted to an appropriate service at first contact with the practice. Practices will be therefore no longer be able to request that patients contact the practice at a later time. In 2023, the Scottish Government published the General Practice Access Principles, which states that people should have a reasonable choice about how they access services and that the method should be clear, understandable and transparent. The Scottish Government notes that the Healthcare Improvement Scotland Primary Care Access Programme has worked with over 100 general practices to improve access arrangements. Do members have any comments or suggestions? Mr Mundell?
Yeah, I mean, I'm very strongly supportive of the aims of the petition, and it's a problem I see regularly as a constituency MSP with particularly vulnerable and elderly patients struggling to, and those who have to travel, struggling with long-term, chronic conditions to interact with this kind of same-day policy. And I think it would be worthwhile trying to find out how prevalent it is across the country. And I think we could achieve that by writing to the Scottish Government to ask how many GP practices are now operating on a same-day-only appointment system, to seek its views on the health and care experience survey results, and also to seek its views on NHS England's recent change to the GP contract, which states that patients should be offered an assessment of need or signposted to an appropriate service at the first contact with the practice, with practices no longer being able to request the patient contact at a later time and ask. And we could ask the Scottish Government whether it's looking at a similar approach, and if it's minded to whether there is flexibility to make a similar change within the existing general medical services contract. And I don't want to kind of add unduly to the committee's workload, but I would also be interested in knowing the views of health boards across Scotland on this issue, as they are, they have a responsibility in relation to primary care. And I think there are several examples around the country where poor access to primary care is causing wider challenges in the health service, with higher numbers of people than average presenting, for example, at A&E. So I would be keen to ask health boards as well for their view on whether or not this practice is something that's happening in the areas of they're responsible for, and how common they think it is.
Thank you for that, Mr Mundell. Mr Chowdhury?
I totally agree with what Oliver Mundell just said, but I just want to add, I've been getting quite a lot of constituents who've been coming and saying that they can't sleep at night if they have to make a phone call in the morning. So that with the time window to call between 8 and 9, and people can't get through. And if they go through, they've been told otherwise to go online, and a lot of people cannot use the online. So I think it's time that the government need to step up there and talk to the GPs and find out a solution, because that's a major issue.
Thank you, Mr. Chowdhury. I think there's not many around this table. Mailbag will not be continually filled with about on-day appointments. So within these recommendations, are the committee happy? Thank you. Concludes the public part of our meeting today, and our next meeting will take place after recess on Wednesday, 17th of April 2024. We now move into private session to consider items 4 and 5.